So thank you. I will give a presentation on the future European power system under different climate policies. And this is a project that has been going on for 4 or 5 years, and I'll tell you a little bit about the team. But first, try to motivate the presentation. The greatest challenge that the energy system in years to come is facing is how to satisfy a growing demand and at the same time become more sustainable. And we have already seen earlier today that there's a lot of different technology choices we can make, and there's a lot of different policy measures that will support some of these technologies. And just to mention some examples, for example, a carbon price. You could put a price on pollution using a tax or a cap and price scheme like the ETS in the EU. You could have subsidies like a feed-in tariff for wind and solar in Germany. You could have regulations like emission performance standards on, for example, a fossil power plant based on coal. And what we will look into is, in this case, only two different policy scenarios that combine different policy measures, also looking at putting in a renewable portfolio mix like the EU 2020, and see what kind of futures can these policies lead to. And the two scenarios we will look at, we'll come back to that, both are aiming at the 2-degree target for temperature reductions in this case. And in 15 minutes, of course, it's limited what we can do, but we'll try to give a small introduction to how these different policy scenarios could influence the European power market. And in particular, look at what will happen with generation expansion, that's the production of energy, what will happen with grid development, that's how we can transport energy from the producer to the consumer, and emissions. And in particular, we want to look at Norway's role because of the resources we have in hydropower and natural gas. Look at how can these two natural resources play a role in this transition, and will that role be different in these two scenarios? But I first need to say something about the team that has been working for almost 5 years on this project. In the United States, we have Joint Global Change Research Institute, who is partly owned by University of Maryland and also by Pacific Northwest. They have been doing the global modeling. So they use an integrated assessment model. It's a global model that looks at the world at a quite aggregated level, but with a technology-rich focus. And they try to model the economic development, the land use, the energy system, the agricultural system, and also the emission effects. And climate effects in a global setting. At our side, in SINTEF and at NTNU, we have been looking at the European power system, and we have been looking at this at the country level, looking at import-export channels between different countries, but also what should each country do to try to match the assumptions in the global model on Europe's behavior for the next 30, 40, 50 years. And I can mention also that we take from the global model the global prices for CO2, global fuel prices, and also we take the European demand, which is in equilibrium with these prices, as an input from the global model. So the GCAM tool, GCAM is the name of this integrated assessment model that the US friends are working on, splits the world into 16 regions. And there's no geographical details for this region. It just says we collect all the demand and supply and all the economy in this region into one point. And of course, this gives a very aggregated view of what is happening in the world. At the same time, they do the same with 5-year steps on investments. So they look at capacity expansions and prices in this system as 5-year averages. So that's what we do with the global model. In the Ramona L model, which is a local power system model that we use for Europe, we have a more detailed geographical view. So we model each European country and the import-export channels. And we also do it in a 5-year steps in terms of capacity expansions. But when it comes to the operations, we need to go into the details. Because when you look at all the wind power, all the solar power that Europe invests in these days, they have variations both in the hours, they have variations in the minutes. And you need to look at how is this system going to work together with the fossil fuels and the hydropower. And in that case, you need to go into detail and model some of the hours as well. And I just give you one example of what could happen in a single hour in a country in Europe. So this would be the vertical line, demand, and you have load on the x-axis, so this would be the demand for electricity, and the vertical line would be one demand point. And the nice curve you have there is the supply curve. So with price at the y-axis, how much will there be available of renewable resources, nuclear, bio, coal, hydro, at specific prices? And that's how you construct a supply curve. And this you have to do for every hour, because if you look at the renewables, for example, it's uncertain. You don't know how much wind is going to blow. You don't know how much solar energy you're going to get out in one specific hour. And you need to look at this dynamically over time, but with a very detailed resolution. If you base this on average prices, you get a very different assumption on how the energy system is going to be operated, and that's not good enough to make investments. So, if you go to the scenario descriptions, I mentioned two scenarios. Both of them are aiming at the 2-degree target. And both of them, in the GCAM model, the global model that does the climate modeling, reaches this 2-degree target, but with very different measures. So the global 2020 scenario is a continuation of the EU 2020 policy, but where we assume that it will also be used as the global way of dealing with climate change. So each region of the world will take part in the same way as Europe at different times, implementing a similar strategy. And of course, the objectives of the global 2020 will towards 2050 be more like an 80% reduction in emissions, and 80% renewables could also be a situation. So it continues the EU policy, but increases the ambition. The 450 stabilization scenario is a scenario that aims at 450 parts per million of CO2 equivalents in the atmosphere. And it only uses a carbon price to reach that target. So it says it's up to the investors how they would like to achieve this objective. In the 2020 scenario, you use a diversified portfolio with energy efficiency, energy savings, with renewables, and with an emission cap. In this one, you let the price manage it all. So when you look at the electricity demand in Europe, if you look at the 450 parts per million, you see that it's a quite high electricity demand. In fact, 5,800 terawatt hours is the estimate of the GCAM model in that case. This comes because if you want to reach the 450 target with a price like that, you need an electrification of society. So that means that you substitute other more polluting energy sources, for example, in industry and in transport, so that you get an electrification of society. In the more diversified strategy, Global 2020, you see a demand which is smaller, 4,800 terawatt hours, because you have been doing energy savings measures and you have also used more of the biofuels in this setting. So this is the starting point, just what comes from the global model. CO2 prices, you see the same when you only base all your climate measures on a CO2 price. You see they behave quite similarly in the beginning, but at one point, the CO2 price for the 450 parts per million scenario is increasing a lot to be able to reach this ambitious climate objective. While for the 2020, you see that there's a lot of other measures going on, like renewable energy implementations, energy savings, and that will lead to a lower CO2 price. Of course, you spend society's money to implement renewable energy and also to implement different technologies. So the cost of the two might be quite similar or even more expensive for the 2020, but it's a more diversified strategy. So it could be interesting to have a look at the energy mix in these two. I'm not going in very much detail, but you could have a look at the 450 scenario, and you see that there is a lot more fossil fuels going on, but with CCS coming in. You also see that in this case, the nuclear is almost twice as high as in the diversified strategy, and there's less wind. And that's the main difference, except that you get more bioenergy also with CCS. So these are some fundamental differences where the diversified strategy has more focus on the renewable, also on, in this case, and also on reducing demand since there is less installed capacity. So the results, this is always a very difficult figure to show because it breaks it down to country level. This is what Ramona L. power system model that we have does. And there's always someone in the audience that says, this is not what my country is going to do. And that's probably true, because this is just an example of how Europe could meet the energy mix suggested by the GCAM model. But it's very interesting to see, for example, from a Norwegian perspective, or neighbors in Germany, Great Britain, France, here, and you see phasing out nuclear, the model suggests bioenergy as one way of dealing with energy demand. In France, nuclear is still a preferred technology, and in the UK, you get more wind coming into the system, but also some nuclear. Let's compare this to the 450 scenario. So just have a look at what happens to the graphs. You see with the 450, you get more CCS and coal in Germany. You get less wind. You get still more nuclear in France. And for the Great Britain, you would get more nuclear and more wind and more coal. So they do more of all because you need to meet a higher demand. So just going back and forward so you can see all the differences. I realize you need some more time to study the details. But one important difference, in the 450 scenario, you have 14.2% non-dispatchable renewables. That's renewables that cannot be planned, like wind and solar. You produce when the sun is shining and the wind is blowing, so you cannot plan it. In the 2020 scenario, you have 21.4. And of course, these are rough estimates. This is something that's going to happen 30 years from now, so I think maybe we don't need the decimals in this case. But still, they give you a fundamental difference between the two scenarios. This points at something interesting for Norway. When you cannot plan such a huge part of your energy system, you need to look at how can you move energy in time. For example, using storages to handle seasonal variations, winter and summer differences, to handle weekly variations, when the wind stops blowing for 2 weeks, you still need to meet energy demand, and hourly variations. Well, for example, the sun shines more in the middle of the day than in the morning and the afternoon, and to handle these situations, you need flexible energy sources, energy carriers, and you need storage. What effect does these differences have on the infrastructure? So this would be a suggested infrastructure. Again, this is 30 years from now, so it's pretty depending on the costs you assume for building these grids. But at least it indicates some fundamental differences again. Interestingly, we see a strengthening between Norway and UK, with a lot of wind in the UK. And as a solution, you can also send the surplus down to France. And we see a strengthening going east-west in Europe. Probably meaning that you introduce a lot of flexibility for how to exchange energy between European countries in this situation. In the 450 scenario, remember, this was a more electrified scenario, but also with more fossil fuels and less non-dispatchables, you get a situation like this. So you saw in this area that you reduced some of the capacity, you have less non-dispatchable energy, it's easier to plan, you may need less transmission, and also you reduce the capacity going here. I'm not going into the 650 scenario because that's depressing. That would be a 650 parts per million scenario, which would mean to a warm climate, a lot more fossil fuels. But I show you the picture of the suggested grid in that case. That would look like this. Even more of this flexibility is valued, less of this flexibility is valued, but you increase this axis east-west in Europe. Of course, this is highly uncertain, but it gives you some ideas about what this non-dispatchable energy and the share of fossil fuels in the system, what that might mean. I will give you some more examples of this. So looking into power exchange. This is power exchange, net power exchange out of Norway in 2050 in the 2020 scenarios. So this would be the four seasons, and this would be the average power exchange per hour in the four seasons. And you see an interesting hourly pattern where you have little export during the morning and night and more export during the day. So this is a typical hourly pattern that you can, well, first of all, you utilize the storage in the hydropower system and you need a flexible system like the hydropower system to be able to do this. We also see in some months that we both export and import. And you see that the import is decreasing also in the afternoon. So you see the same hourly pattern. In the 450 scenario, this was the more electrified scenario, you see not as strong, less pronounced, but you see the same kind of overlay pattern also in this situation with a quite different energy mix in Europe. So it indicates there might be something interesting going on here. On the other hand, you see that this is much more pronounced also as an import scenario. And in fact, I think it is fair to go through the assumptions we did on the demand and supply side here. In the 4,800 terawatt-hour European demand, in the diversified portfolio scenario, we assume that Norway's demand is increasing in the same way as Europe's demand, 262 terawatt-hours, while the Norwegian capacity is increasing by 20.1 gigawatt new installed capacity. That would need to a net import of 29 terawatt-hours. On the other hand, in the electrified scenario, we assume the same demand increase in Norway. This could be electrification of the transport sector, electrification of the Norwegian continental shelf, but we don't increase the capacity. And this is maybe in the middle of the estimates we have for how Norwegian renewable energy capacity can be built out, unless we really boost building out much more wind energy. So this is not very conservative, but also not very optimistic view on Norwegian capacity. So if you increase the demand side and don't do anything with the supply side, you need a net import of 7 terawatt hours. Still, the seasonal variation is there, and the hourly variation is there. And of course, this flexibility is what we are discussing here. How can this flexibility influence how can this Norwegian flexibility be used in the European system? And then I would say that these numbers, demand and capacity, they are political decisions and can of course be changed. So this is not something we look into, but we say this would be the consequences. Can the Norwegian system handle this? This is a picture of the Norwegian hydro reservoir's energy content. This is 100% full, and this is cycles showing the seasonal variation. And it's always 10 to 20 terawatt hours of free capacity in these hydro reservoirs. And of course, it's not given that you can utilize all this, because behind these reservoirs and the European energy system is a very complex power system, but it shows, again, some of the potential. For the natural gas, you see some of the same variations. You see here in different seasons, three different days, but you see from 35 gigawatt hours per hour down to 0 gigawatt hours per hour in the same season, just different days. And you also see a huge variation within days. And you see this effect both in the 450 and 2020 scenario, but again, I show you the 2020 scenario. So it shows that natural gas role in these days is as a very flexible tool in the European energy system, balancing out the energy needs. And we looked into, does the Norwegian gas system have this capacity? We have the storage capacity in pipelines. Just to give you a brief indication again, this storage capacity could, for example, be increased by 135 gigawatt hours within 12 hours. And we saw in the pictures between 0 and 35. Okay, so I'll finish in 30 seconds. Yeah. So we have the challenges. Investment in cables needs to handle the future demand for flexibility. Will it happen under the right policy uncertainty? It might require a change in legislation to offer part of the hydropower and gas pipeline capacity as a commercial flexibility service. And the ultimate question, who is going to pay for grid expansions? If this is offered as commercial services to Europe, who will pay the cost of building infrastructure in both sides? Thank you.